So this Sunday, in New Orleans at the Superdome, WrestleMania 34. What do they used to call it? The Showcase of the Immortals? WrestleMania is here. And even when the build-up has been crap, as it has been this year, even when the card looks like mostly trash, as this year's does, it is still Mania. There is still a buzz and a tangible excitement level increase because you have that hope, you have that anticipation, that expectation. And it comes from being a WWE fan. It comes from being a wrestling fan. It comes from knowing that this is the big shebangabang. Sorry, New Japan fans and Wrestle Kingdom. Your show is not this one, period. But we have a significant problem here with these major wrestling shows getting to be way too damn long. Quantity of matches does not automatically equal a quality of matches. Furthermore, quantity of length of time of show does not automatically translate to quality of time for the length of show. Imagine being somebody that goes and has to sit through 7+ hours of shit live. That's a really damn long haul. Or you're like me, and you're sitting at home and watching it, whether by yourself or with others. If you factor in that kickoff show and you actually watch that, but even if you didn't, you're still talking about the main card. You're anticipating going 5+ damn hours. Throw in the kickoff show, 7+ damn hours. It is too damn much. Just because it is the biggest show of the year does not mean that it needs to be this damn long. You can make a show feel big in other ways than just making it longer than any other damn show out there. And especially in a year like this, where the buildup has been substandard, the match card is substandard, the last thing I want to do is have to sit there and watch this much damn wrestling. I hope 5-Hour Energy is a major sponsor of this event. If not, they should be, because people are going to need to chug a 5-Hour Energy in order to make it through all the way through this damn show. For Christ's sakes, look at the kickoff show. It's going to be, what, 2+ hours? You got 3 matches on that beast, and 2 of them are Battle Royals. The Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. Why do we even bother with this thing other than literally just to make sure everybody gets a spot on the Mania card? I applaud the socialistic aspect of trying to say, hey, we want to make sure everybody gets a WrestleMania payout for having to deal with this company and its crap over the course of a year. But it doesn't matter if it's on the kickoff show, and everybody knows that. Same thing with this women's battle royal. I know you're trying to get every woman on the show as much as you possibly can. But you made this big announcement and made this big deal out of it with this vagina-shaped freaking trophy just so that way it could be on the kickoff show. And then the Cruiserweight Championship Tournament Final. Cedric Alexander and Mustafa Ali. Oh, Triple H is overseeing 205 Live. That automatically makes it better. Ah, because again, we know if it's on the kickoff show, it is shit. We know if it is on the kickoff show, it doesn't matter. Why in the hell should anybody care about the Cruiserweights when they're always on the kickoff show? Thankfully, I look at this kickoff show and I say, you know what? This is definitely 2 hours that I can miss. Thank you for that, WWE. Now I'm going to get ready to talk about the main card and all the matches we have on there. What is it, 11 of them at this point? Including one that hasn't been announced, but everybody assumed is there. I'll give you my thoughts on what should happen, what needs to happen, what probably will happen. Oh, the sweet irony that it would be that 4 years after being WrestleMania in a lot of ways in New Orleans, 4 years after closing out the show and sending the people home happy, yes, 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 that Daniel Bryan would go from main eventing WrestleMania 30 to opening up WrestleMania 34. Now, I'm not saying that's guaranteed to happen. It might not happen. But I do contend that it should happen. Not just for my own sadistic pleasure of seeing that, but also because if you want to get WrestleMania off to a hot start, if you want to get WrestleMania going in a good direction, then kick it off with Daniel Bryan so that way 70+ thousand smart fans can sit there and giggly tits about it. There's still a part of me that thinks this whole thing was about getting Shane McMahon a WrestleMania victory. I know he beat his dad at WrestleMania 17 and da-da-da-da-da. But I'm talking about in this new run of Shane, it doesn't do any good for him to always wrestle at WrestleMania if he's always going to lose. And the funny thing is this is one of the matches that has the most build-up to it. And it absolutely should open this show. Have Daniel Bryan go over, and the fans are happy, and you start the show off with some good vibes. I do wonder, with every single title looking like it could potentially change hands at this show, if that means one or two of them might not. And if one was destined to potentially not change hands, it might be the U.S. Championship in this Fatal 4-Way. And look, I would understand if that's the direction they went. But we're going to need some positive vibes to get through the long night. And to me, even though he was thrown in at the last minute, by far the most over individual in this match is Rusev. We need WrestleMania to be Rusev Day. Rusev should be the next United States champion, and let's hope to God that's what happens. What looks like potentially 11 matches on the main card, if you throw in Cena versus somebody, and knowing there's going to be other stuff that goes on, you're going to need to cut some time somewhere. The Raw Women's Championship is the perfect place to do it. The way this has been built up, the way this is done, you need a squash match on this card. Nia Jax should squash Alexa Bliss in under a minute. Don't have a long competitive match. You're going to have enough of those on this damn card. You're going to have too many of those on this damn card. You need a match that is different, a match that is short, and this is the one to do it with. Have Nia come out, squash Alexa. Doesn't hurt Alexa. Still quality enough as a heel. Gets Nia over as a monster babyface. Everybody wins and we can move the hell on. This whole thing about Braun Strowman having to pick out a tag team partner for WrestleMania. I do kind of wish they went down that Matt Morgan route, as a couple of people have pointed out previously, and just had him be the tag team champions. Say, we are the tag team champions. If you don't like it, you can catch these hands. Like, you look at Braun Strowman, why the hell would he need a tag team partner? But nonetheless, he's going to get one. Is it going to be Elias? Is it going to be Bray Wyatt? It's probably going to be Rey Mysterio because, yes, as rumors have talked about, that is exactly the type of thing that Vince McMahon gets off on still to this day. That is the type of thing that he loves. Let's put the big guy with the small guy and make magic happen. I look at this Intercontinental Championship triple threat. This has a chance to be a match that could be one of the surprises of the night. It really does. You got Rollins, you got Balor, you got The Miz. And I might be in the minority here, and I'm used to that. To me, this should be a Miz showcase. I'm sorry, Seth Rollins as a mid-card champion? No thank you. Fucking Finn Balor and his blue Balor ass? No thank you. The Miz just had a baby now. I know maybe he's going to want some time off post-WrestleMania. But the dude has been so valuable to the WWE in recent years. He deserves, as one of the best Intercontinental Champions in recent history, and perhaps of all time, if you really sit down and think about it, when he is a mid-card champion, that belt matters a whole hell of a lot more. He makes those belts meaningful and significant, unlike what Seth Rollins or Finn Balor would do with them. You can't have every single title change hands on this damn show. As a result, to me, it would be an absolute crock of shit and a crime if The Miz did not retain successfully here at WrestleMania. He's earned that right, he deserved that right, and WWE needs to make it happen. One of the things I want to see is what they're going to do with Elias at WrestleMania. I don't think he's in the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. Maybe he is and I just missed it and I didn't care. I hope that's not the case, because there are bigger things they could do with him. There is that part of me that may hope that he is Braun Strowman's tag partner. Not bad work if you can get it. But there's that real part of me, and don't kill the dream for me! There's that real part of me, I don't care what's been said, I don't care if he says he's not going to be there. There's this real part of me that wants a concert face-off between Elias and The Rock. Can an old wrestling fan get that? Can I have one here? Can I get one, please? Can you imagine Elias and The Rock having a face-off, having a concert, having a sing-along? Oh my God, it would be fucking epic. And a true WrestleMania moment, better than anything that Elias could do in terms of in the ring. And no, substituting Kid Rock in there does not make a difference. It has to be Elias and it has to be The Rock. Please, WWE, for the love of God, make it happen. I can say, for this year's WrestleMania, justice is being served for the Usos and the New Day. They deserve to have a featured WrestleMania match. They deserve to have a WrestleMania match on the main card. And by God, they're getting it this year. Well deserved for both teams. some reason we have to shoehorn in the Bludgeon Brothers here. I don't know why. But the thing that stands out to me about this match, other than the fact that the New Day and the Usos deserve to actually have a tag title match here on the WrestleMania main card, is that on this show, you have a triple threat like this match. You have a Fatal 4-Way for the U.S. title. You have tag matches, mixed tag matches. As far as I can tell right now, there's not a single match with any type of extreme stipulation. And that just seems ridiculous. And if there was a place to put that in, to break up kind of the monotony of just having standard match after standard match after standard match, it might very well have been this one. Three teams, tables match, you could do a ladder match, you could do a damn TLC match. Like, that would have taken this match on a whole different plane to me. This would have taken this match to a whole different place and probably ensured that it was one of the highlights of the night. It still may end up being so in terms of actual match quality. But I thought this was a real missed opportunity here by WWE to get something different on this card. And it felt like the timing would be right to do some type of tables match or a ladder match or, like I said, a TLC match. I don't know about any of you, but the whole build-up to this potential John Cena-Undertaker match has been the absolute shits. Even though it was already a match that I didn't want to see because it's 5 years too late, to me, Undertaker is done. John Cena has long since passed the point of major relevancy here. You still could have made something out of this. And instead, they've done nothing. Because the last time you didn't have Taker show up until WrestleMania, that worked out really well, right, with Bray Wyatt. Am I right? Of course it didn't. And now we're getting to the point. What a bizarre world we live in. To where this isn't even an officially announced match on the card. Like, John Cena versus The Undertaker isn't even officially touted on the website. It's not even officially mentioned on the website. So at some point in time during the night, we're just magically going to throw this in to the middle of the damn show. Who wins? John Cena? The Undertaker? Nobody wins! It's a lose-lose damn situation all the way around! As far as the WWE Championship goes with Shinsuke Nakamura and AJ Styles, to me it belongs somewhere in the middle of the card. Just let him go out there. Have 25, 30 minutes. Give the hardcore fans something to celebrate, something to smile about. Probably going to need to fill some time at some point during the show. This is the match that they should do it. Now, there's a part of me that wonders, even with all the buildup to this match, if AJ Styles isn't going to end up retaining at WrestleMania. And there's a part of me as well that looks at this and says, I hope to God that AJ Styles does retain at WrestleMania because I'm sorry. I cannot take Shinsuke Nakamura on seriously as one of your major brands world champion. And can you imagine him as the world champion having a compelling feud? He hadn't done anything compelling since his main roster run began. Why would it change now as the world champion, for Christ's sakes? I know there are a lot of fans that really think the SmackDown Women's Championship between Asuka and Charlotte Flair has the potential to tear the roof off the motherfucker Superdome. They think that this could be great, this could be epic. And there is a major part of me that is really worried about this match. Yes, potentially, it has that big fight feel for the ladies. It feels like a dream match for the ladies in terms of the current roster. But Asuka at times can be choppy in the ring. And Charlotte has a bad, bad habit to me of being a botchy bitch. I really worry about this stage in front of that many people that these two could go out there and deliver up to the expectations that people are going to have. Now, surely you're going to have those that are just going to think it's great because it was Asuka and Charlotte Flair or whatever. But in terms of truly delivering, this is one of these matches that I look at where some matches might surprise on the positive. There's a chance to me that this match could surprise on the negative and not live up to people's expectations. That said, we'll see what happens once Asuka wins this match, and now you've got Road Dogg in charge of booking her. Good luck with that one. I still wonder, in part because there might be a concern about if Brock Lesnar's done with WWE after Mania, that he might not perform up to the standards that they expect out of a main event. Also tying in with all the stuff that WWE has done, talking about making history and first ever, and this is historic. There's still a major part of me that wonders if the Angle Rousey versus Triple H Stephanie McMahon match isn't going to end up main eventing WrestleMania. I'll be stunned if it's not second to last. I'd also kind of be stunned if it doesn't main event. Because with how much as they're trying to pretend like they've now invented women's wrestling and they're the only company in the world that's ever taken women's wrestling seriously, now you've got a tag match that features two women. One of the participants is a freaking McMahon, and the other participant is freaking Ronda Rousey, your biggest signing you've had since Brock Lesnar. Former UFC person. Somebody you're going to try and build that Raw women's division around. There are a lot of elements here that sit there and say that this match might main event, and maybe it should main event. Because I know people are going to sit there and say, I don't want that going on last. You know what? In theory, maybe. But at the end of a five-hour show, is it going to matter that much? Like, Lesnar Reigns could go out there and completely tear the house down, and people are going to be sitting on their hands mostly asleep. So why not throw out there this match instead? So that way at least it fits with WWE's recent panache of trying to make everything first ever and historic. As far as this though, you only often get one chance to make a first impression. And this is going to be critical for WWE's Ronda Rousey. To me, the real interest here was Ronda and Stephanie anyways. In an ideal world, this would have just been a singles match. Frankly, Triple H and Kurt Angle are bit players here. God is a bit player to his wife, but that's exactly how it is. God just made sure that he got himself a big-time payoff for working a feature match at WrestleMania. Praise God! Ugh! Well, this match is about Ronda Rousey and the real baddest woman in WWE, Stephanie McMahon. I mean, seriously, you look at those two. You don't think Stephanie McMahon could go blow for blow with Ronda Rousey? Just saying. Especially when you peep them mom arms? Just saying. But Ronda Rousey has one chance to make a good first impression in the ring. And that's what this whole match is about. Surely she's going to get the one-up on Stephanie. She's going to make her tap, whatever. But if Ronda Rousey performs poorly here, it's going to be a really, really bad look for WWE. Outside of all the mainstream press and publicity that they're going to get out of this for Rousey working her first ever WWE match and it being at WrestleMania. When we get to the match that right now I think is the presumed main event, a lot of people assume it's the main event because we know Vince has been pining for this for a year, and we know that Roman Reigns has already worked three straight WrestleManias, so logic holds that he probably gets a fourth one. And all I gotta say is WWE better hope that Brock Lesnar shows up. They better hope that WWE gets the best out of Brock Lesnar. Yeah, he'll physically show up, but you know what I mean. Is this going to be a WrestleMania 20 thing where he sits there and says, I'm done after this anyways, so I don't give a shit? Good God, I hope not. Because as much as you want to crap on Reigns, as much as you want to do this or that, I'm already ready to move on from Brock Lesnar. Good riddance. I just don't want to see his last match be like WrestleMania 20 was. I hope he has enough personal and professional pride and enough respect for Roman, enough respect for Vince, enough respect for the business and the company that he goes out there and performs. Like, you look at last year, the match with him and Goldberg. It wasn't long, but goddamn, it was magnificent for what it was. These guys have had a good WrestleMania match in the past, but you don't have Seth Rollins cashing in as you're out this time. Now is your chance to get it right. And we're going to find out. We'll see how the crowd reacts to this. If they're sitting on their hands or if this has that big fight feeling. We're going to find out. I hope to God for the company's sake that this match delivers. Right now, I'm really on the fence about whether or not it will. When I look back at this card that I've just gone over here, it's underwhelming. Really, really underwhelming. It's a substandard card for what is supposed to be your biggest, most important show of the year. And just because you put more matches on the card doesn't make the card any better. I mean, for Christ's sakes, we're in a bizarro place where Cena versus Taker is supposed to be one of your feature matches, and it's not even officially announced! It's just going to be a surprise freaking throw-in potentially at Mania on Sunday! Like, seriously, what the hell? Oh, my God. I hope this show delivers. Especially if the company is asking us to sink this much time into watching it on Sunday. It better deliver. Because if not, you know, come Sunday night, early Monday morning, I'll be on here raging and bitching about it all the live long day.